When you start learning JavaScript right now, you're probably learning about the modern import-export statements, which we have both in the browser and in Node.js and even in Dino. But do you know how we got to this syntax that we have today? Do you know what features we gained at what point in time? Let's take a look at the 7 levels of JavaScript modules. Let's learn about namespaces, dependencies, globals, and even asynchronicity. Let's get into it. Level 1. Globals. In this example, you should imagine I have a separate HTML file which includes either one or multiple script tags. I have a file which contains all my definitions. I might have multiple class definitions in the old syntax via prototypical inheritance, and I might have consumers of that class, the call sites, where I'm using this class, and there is no difference in scope here. Functions have their own scope, as of course is a JavaScript language feature, but there is no scope around this my constant, for example. There's no way that this code can access this. Using globals without any form of structure, module structure, is really the dark ages of JavaScript. This wasn't practiced a lot, and this was heavily used way before in the beginning, like in the 90s when JavaScript was just invented. Node.js is from 2009. But already then we had a few patterns that were better than this. This is really no module system at all. If you write a lot of code this way, you will quickly run into problems like name clashing. There's no scope around this, so you have basically one scope for your entire app. Your classes cannot have duplicate names, your variables cannot have duplicate names. There's no way to shield one part of code from another part of code, no encapsulation at all. Another big problem is that your implementations are next to your consumers, your call sites. That means that it is very easy to ignore the separation of concern best practices. If you have written this code, why would you even make it a function? I mean, you could just take this over here and paste this variable name over here, and then why make it reusable at all? It's difficult to think in terms of input and output and pure functions. Level 2 is namespaces. I've created a new object on the window global, and if it's already there, I'm reusing it, where I can define my classes and variables and whatever. I can define it on top of that namespace, and I will not define it on the global, so that at least I'm not sharing scope anymore. I am hereby signaling to myself in the future and my colleagues, this thing belongs to this namespace. Don't reuse it outside of this namespace. If you will, if at another call site you will look at this code and you will say my constant over here, then this will be a smell. This will be, hey, you're using something that is not supposed to use. At least it's visible. It's not impossible, but at least it's visible. So the next natural question that programmers of that time were asking themselves is, how can we get true private variables, variables that are encapsulated in a scope that nobody else can use, so that I can create true privacy inside of a class, for example. And this was done via the immediately invoked function expression. This first line and the last line is an example of that syntax. It is basically a function that is immediately executed, that's hence its name. IIFE stands for immediately invoked function expression. It is a function that is immediately invoked, and it is a function expression. So a function that looks like this is a function statement. If you put brackets around it, it is a function expression. If you run it immediately, if you invoke it immediately, it becomes an immediately invoked function expression. This is an IIFE. It's a funny name, I think, because IIFE is also, this syntax looks a bit IIFE. But it is a nice way to create a new scope. Functions are the only thing in JavaScript that create scope, apart from the ES modules that we'll get to in the future. They do really have the feature of an internal definition available right now. This is truly private. There's no global right now. If you define a module this way, this my class can really not be accessed outside of this function. And while this solves the problem of privacy, it did not solve the problem of the consumer, the call site of this class, being located together with the implementation. Otherwise, it doesn't have access to this variable. So this IIFE, the basic definition of an IIFE, was evolved into the module pattern, also called the revealing module pattern. Level 4. The module pattern is really different from anything we've seen before because it introduced the feature of specifying the dependencies you require as your module, your class, or whatever functionality you're trying to wrap, specifying those dependencies as arguments, and then also making other functionality that you've just implemented in this file or in this module, making it available by returning specifically only what you want. So you still have the internal definition, a truly private variable. You don't rely on globals anymore, but you also have the choice of what functionality to make available. And the fact that you're very explicit about I need these dependencies and I will return this functionality with this interface means that the consumer, the call side of this class, can be moved somewhere else completely. It can be put in another file, it can be loaded over the network, it doesn't matter anymore. This now is a standalone unit that you can reuse. This was a huge win. Not huge in the sense that this was anything new outside of JavaScript. Many programming languages had these features already, but for JavaScript it was new in the sense that it was a standard that everybody started using back then. That was the win. By the way, this code doesn't actually work this way. It's just an illustration of how it was used back then because jQuery was often the thing that was included. And then in 2009, two major things happened. It basically split the landscape of modules. We got Node.js with the CommonJS standard, which I'll talk about in a bit, and we got Require.js with the AMD spec, the asynchronous module definition. They both tried to solve for the same features, but AMD is way more comprehensive, so I'll talk about Node.js first. Node.js is level 5. They didn't really introduce any new features. They introduced new syntax. So require is the way to pull in dependencies, and exports, assigning to the exports object or the module exports object, is the way to export certain functionality, to share it and make it reusable with other files requiring this code. And it also creates a scope, but it's a sort of hidden scope. You don't see the function scope around it, but it is actually there. Node.js, while loading your code, wraps your source code files with these kind of statements. So it has a function that creates the scope, which is called with the exports, require, module, and other arguments there to be able to define these things that we're using. So if I were to literally paste this code in here, then now you would see this require is this require that you're calling, this exports is this exports that you're assigning to. Suddenly it can be used in this way. Then level 6, the asynchronous module definition, pioneered with Require.js, but implemented in other frameworks as well. So it starts with a define function that the framework defines for you. Then you specify your array of dependencies. Then you have a function, a callback function that is called when your dependencies are available. Remember, this is an asynchronous module definition. Then your function is called with your dependencies. If you would have multiple dependencies here, you would have multiple variables being injected as arguments into that function. Then you can have your function definition, and finally, whatever you return from this function, just like with the IIFE, that you make available to other call sites and other code that uses this functionality. In AMD, there's actually multiple ways of retrieving asynchronous dependencies. The other way is to only ask for a require dependency to be injected, which is then a function you can call, and again you will have your callback called whenever it's ready with your dependencies, which is then something you could use if this was a module that would also take some time to load from wherever. Now you have another way to define this. If you would, for example, have to run some code to determine to have some logic over here, then you can later on determine which dependencies you want to require. This enables more comprehensive features, such as dynamic dispatch, which is a very fancy way of saying, at runtime, I want to determine whether I want to use implementation A or B. They may have the same interface. The call site may not need to know which one of these is used, but I will determine this at runtime and then give that dependency through. This is supported by something like this module definition. And because back then we had both the Node.js common standard and the AMD standard, the universal module definition, or UMD, was also created, which is a lot of code to use as a module definition. This is a bunch of boilerplate code that you would need to paste at the beginning of every file for it to have the capability to be used within a require.js within the browser context, but also within a Node.js context on the server. If you would want to use code, isomorphic code that you have written, logic you can use both in the server and the client, you could use this module pattern to have it available anywhere. This is of course, there's some duplicate code here. This is not an ideal way of doing things. This didn't gain massive popularity, not as popular as CommonJS and AMD in any way, because there's jQuery here, there's another dependency array over here, but then as arguments in a slightly different syntax, and there's fallbacks and whatnot. So this can of course be confusing, and it's a lot of boilerplate. And in 2015, we got to level 7, the ECMAScript modules, which has now become the default way of doing modules, both in the browser and on the server. They have an import statement, they have export statements. They both support many different ways. You can import default names as well. If you want to import directly from math, this is possible. You can export a list of named exports. You can export default so that the unnamed export can be, the name can be chosen by the call site. This in a way is again not a new feature. This is just fancy syntax for something. But now at least it is in the language standard. So there isn't this AMD versus CommonJS, browser versus Node.js discussion anymore. Both can use the same syntax. A few years later, we also got the import function, which is different from the import statement. It also has a different color. This needs to be awaited. So in a function that is an async function, you can await square root with this import statement. This will be valid code. Again, it means this function has become a asynchronous function. It returns a promise. After this has been loaded, the next lines can be executed. And in Dino, you even have fancy import new syntax that they invented themselves that is not compatible with Node. So there comes the problem again of different ways of doing things. Up until now, this code would have worked for Dino as well, but here you need to specify a specifier that is unique to Dino, that isn't supported by anything else. To summarize, modules allow for code structuring in a nice way. We suddenly have the features of creating a certain boundary between two different files. They both have encapsulation. Their own privates cannot be accessed by the other module. It's a different thing. They have to decide explicitly, what thing do I want to import? What thing do I want to export? And this determines the interface of something. Actually, I have a video on this, on interface first programming. Might be a good one if you want to learn more about this. And that's it. I hope you've enjoyed this. I hope this was helpful. If you have any thoughts or requests for things you'd like to see, let me know in the comments. Thank you very much for watching.